This is a lecture on superposition method. This is another method of circuit analysis that you can use on linear circuits when you have more than one independent source. And this method is basically you analyze the circuit one independent source at a time. So here are the steps, and one of the steps you do what we call kill all the independent sources except for one, the one that you're going to analyze at that particular time, and then find voltage and or current for the elements that are in the circuit due to that one source that you didn't kill. And then you repeat this for all the independent sources you have, and then you add up algebraically, you add up all the individual source contributions to get what the total voltage or current is for a particular element. The real pro to this method is that when you kill these sources, you often end up with a simpler circuit to analyze than what you started off with. But the con is that you have to do more work because you have to do an analysis for each source. So, you know, if you have three independent sources in a circuit, that's going to be three analyses that you have to do, as opposed to just one, you know, if you weren't using superposition. So, you know, there's advantages and disadvantages to this method. Now, real key here is that this method only applies to linear circuits, so you have to have a linear relationship between your variables that you're solving for. So I'm going to refer you to this handout that I posted on PolyLearn that talks about the properties of linearity, and you can read through this and see that in circuits there's a linear relationship between voltage and resistance, and also between current and resistance. And it shows the proof here showing the linearity between current and resistance. However, the relationship between power and resistance is not linear. Okay, so you cannot use superposition to find the power for a resistor due to each individual source, and then at the end add them up and get what the real answer is for the total. Okay, and that's because the relationship between power and resistor doesn't have linearity. Okay, so that's one thing you always got to keep in mind with superposition, is you have to have a linear relationship between the variables that you're solving for. So in our circuits, superposition is going to work for finding voltage and or current for a resistor, but we can't use it for power. Okay, so one other thing here that I want to talk about before we do any problems is how you go about killing these sources. So to do that, okay, I have this diagram, as you can see here. And what this is a representation of a voltage source. Okay, often we'll represent a voltage source with a voltage symbol, as you see here, an independent voltage source symbol in series with the resistance that's labeled the internal resistance. And what this resistance represents is energy conversion loss. Actually, let's sneak in energy here. Okay, if you have some, you know, DC source like a chemical battery, not all the chemical energy is converted into electrical energy. There's some loss in the process of that conversion, and we represent it with the resistance like this. Now the dash box is just meaning that, you know, this here is, you know, we don't have direct access to that. We only have access to the source at these terminals and the voltage at the terminals, V terminal. Okay? Well, ideally, this internal resistance would have a value of 0 ohms. Okay, which remember we call a short. See, that would be the ideal value of this resistor that represents conversion loss, because ideally you would have no conversion loss. And if this resistance is 0 ohms, that means that V terminal will always equal Vs, right? Even when I connect something up to these terminals and current starts to flow, if R internal is represented with the short, well, as we learned, there's 0 volts across a short no matter what the current flowing here would be. Okay, and that would be the ideal, that I would always have the most terminal voltage possible that the battery could convert, no matter how much current was flowing from the battery. Okay, so you see, ideally, the internal resistance of a voltage source is 0 ohms, a short. Now, in actuality, of course, you know, it's some finite value. In, you know, good sources have a small amount of internal resistance because there's, you know, very little conversion loss. But if our internal is some other number other than zero, some finite amount here, well, once I connect, you know, some device, you know, D for device, whatever it may be, circuit, and current starts to flow, well, I'll get a voltage drop across that internal resistance. So my V terminal, okay, and I'm just going to use T here for terminal. Well, my V terminal, or TER, okay, the voltage across the terminals would be VS minus the current flowing times whatever the internal resistance is. Okay, this current here, I. Okay, the point being that V terminal is going to be something less than, you know, the most we could get, the VS, because of this voltage drop here, where, you know, ideally when current's flowing, like we said earlier, if you don't have any conversion loss, well, ideally, you know, V terminal would just equal VS. Okay, so the key point of this, really, and the reason I went through this, is this right here, that the ideal internal resistance of a voltage source is zero, a short, because that represents no conversion loss. Well, let's look at this here. This diagram represents a current source, and we often represent current sources with a current source symbol in parallel with the resistor R internal, which again represents the energy conversion loss. And then here at the terminals, the current that would flow once I connected something up to the terminals, that would be our I terminal. Well, ideally, the ideal internal resistance of a current source is infinite ohms. Okay, remember what we call an open. See, because if R internal is an open, when I connect something out here to my terminals, all this source current IS would flow through whatever I connect to the terminals. None of it would be lost inside here. Okay, so you see, ideally, my I terminal would just equal IS. Well, in reality, of course, the actual R internal, it's not infinite ohms. It's going to be something less than infinite ohms. Now, a well-designed current source has a really high R internal. Okay, again, little conversion loss, but there's some there. So that means when I hook something up, you know, some device here, kind of a weird shape there, but, you know, I hook some device and current starts to flow, well, if R internal is something other than an open, some of IS will flow through or be lost in the conversion and be represented by current, you know, flowing through our internal as well as through the device. So you see, I'm going to lose some current here. So IS will have two paths. So now the current at the terminal will be IS minus the current through R internal. Okay, so again, I lose some due to that conversion loss. So the main point here is that ideally the internal resistance of a current source is an open, okay, is infinite ohms. So the reason I stepped you through this is because when you look at this step here of superposition method, and we kill, okay, get rid of independent sources, all except the one that we're going to analyze the circuit for, well, as you're going to see, the way we kill these independent sources is that we replace them with their ideal internal resistances. So when we kill an independent voltage source, we replace it with a short. And when we kill an independent current source, we replace it with an open, because we're replacing them with their ideal internal resistances. And next video, we'll start some problems using this method, superposition.